So you're out wheeling in a remote location like Moab, and you notice that someone just flipped their Jeep. Upon securing the scene, you notice that there are some life-threatening injuries present. Do you have the proper kit and equipment to stabilize that person until the proper medical attention can be sought? Mersh D here, and you're watching Off-Road Medic. On today's episode, I'm going to show you what I carry in my IFAC kit and why you should carry one too. I'm also going to show you how to make one cater to your needs, and stay tuned to the end of this video where I'm going to share with you some helpful tips that can make the difference between life and death, because when trauma occurs, seconds count. Now you're probably thinking, yo D, that'll never happen to me. I don't need that. That's what 911 is for. Well, that's where you're wrong, my friend, because disaster can strike anywhere when we least expect it. And you may not be in a situation where the proper medical attention can be sought in a timely manner. First off, we gotta give some people a reality check, okay? That little Red Cross first aid box you have full of Band-Aids, it's worthless. That's not my opinion, it's just a known fact. So the first question we're gonna start off with is, do you buy a pre-made IFAC or do you make one yourself? In my own personal opinion, I would say make one yourself and cater it to your needs. By making your own IFAC, you'll know what you're putting in there, where it is, and how to use it, hopefully. So the majority of the content in this IFAC can be bought on Amazon. I'm not affiliated with any of these companies. It's just what I choose to run. So first off, let's take a look at this pouch. It's a great portable size. It's red, which gives it away that it's probably a first aid pack. If you had any doubts, red Medic Cross kind of gives it away. It's got a Velcro backing, so you can attach it to just about anything. It also has another platform that attaches to this that you can attach onto your vehicle. Mine sits behind my headrest because that is most easily accessible for me. It's got a MOLLE platform on the front so you can attach essential items that you need to access real quick without having to open the actual pouch itself. So the first item, great pair of carabiner shears. Very sharp, great size. Carabiner clip right here definitely helps keep it in place if you have to have it on your pants or you want to mount it somewhere else. Secondly, attach the carabiner clip for ease of access. CPR face shield. I've got a couple of these and I actually have a big one that I carry in my MFAC, but for now, I just keep this one. It just opens up for mouth-to-mouth resuscitation. Next up is probably one of the most important pieces of this kit, and that's the CAT tourniquet, the combat applicable tourniquet. Okay, this one is from North American Rescue. Now, I can talk about real versus fake, pros versus cons all day. And for those of you that know how a CAT tourniquet works, you know that after applying it, you have to mark the time. So, of course, you should keep a Sharpie or a marker of some sort handy. Now, I'm not gonna show you how to put this on and apply it because that's a whole different video in itself that I'm gonna be creating soon as a part of my Stop the Bleed series. Just know that every first aid kit should have a CAT tourniquet. So upon opening it, the first thing you're gonna see is personal protective equipment, gloves. Every first aid kit should carry gloves. You gotta protect yourself. I prefer the blue gloves or the black gloves because I'm not a chef. I'm not trying to be tactical here. You can see blood on a blue glove. It's kind of hard to see blood on a black glove. Tweezers. Scissors. And here is a 8-inch SAM splint, which is great for when you have bone injuries. You need to make a splint. I've got a couple other different sizes. Next up is a Mylar blanket. So next, another pair of trauma shears. I like shears. These are really small and dinky, but hey, you lose your first pair, it doesn't hurt to have a second, third, or fourth. So next up is gauze and a lot of it. Not all trauma is gonna happen to distal extremities of the body, meaning the hands, arms, and legs. So in case we have trauma to the core or a junction, like around your neck or your thighs, you would pack that wound with gauze and a lot of it. Now, I don't carry hemostatic gauze, which has chemical agents that will aid in coagulation, blood clotting. I can't afford that right now, so I just use regular gauze. Next up, we got some more gauze. Just a rolled up gauze bandage, really good stuff too. This is really good for when you have to pack in those junctions. You just keep the roll behind you and you're just constantly applying pressure as you pack that junction. Next up is an Israeli bandage. This one is from North American Rescue. This is really great for, you know, if you don't have the biggest of wounds on an extremity and you pack it with gauze, then you can place this over as a bandage and it applies pressure for you. So let's say I've used that and I need more bandage. I carry a couple different sizes. This is the Velcro stuff. Really good, super elastic. Next up is a triangle bandage, really good if you need to make a sling. Let's say I exhaust all my SAM splints and I can't make a sling, I ran out of gauze, whatever the case, triangle bandage is really good for that. So next up is what's known as a chest seal. This is also from North American Rescue. Do carry two of these because most gunshot wounds are high velocity, which means you're gonna have an entry point and an exit point. And the reason we apply these is because we want to equalize the pressure and we don't want a lung to collapse. Now you're probably thinking this is overkill. Like, where am I gonna see a gunshot while I'm off-roading? But you know, if you roll the Jeep and something happens, you get stabbed by a piece of metal from the vehicle or a tree branch or something penetrates the thoracic cavity, we want to seal that up. So better to have it and not need it than to need it and not have it. Going back to the trauma shears, I forgot a very key component. We carry trauma shears because if we see blood upon the primary and the secondary sweep, but we can't identify where it's coming from, it's time to tear away some clothing. So it's really good that you have a sharp pair that can cut through denim, leather, whatever it takes to expose the body so that you can find source of trauma. Next up, I've got some what we call tegaderm patches. So let's say you get a small wound, but it's pretty deep and you've packed it with gauze and so forth, and you want to keep it dry. This plastic adhesive is like a film, like a cling wrap. It goes right over. So something that you're probably not going to see too often is a scalpel. In case trauma shears can't do the job or you got a funny angle you need to cut at something, scalpel with a safety cap. I do carry a lot of tape. A couple miscellaneous items that don't take up too much space, alcohol swabs, antibiotic cream, Neosporin. Now I know this may seem like a lot of stuff to carry, but hey, this is the go bag. When shit hits the fan, when you see trauma, you grab this and go. You're addressing immediate needs. You see trauma, grab the bag, go. I do also carry MFAC, a medical first aid kit, which is a bigger bag, has a lot more. So I have an actual CPR mask in there, and that'll be a different video, but this is the immediate threat. There's a lot more things that I could carry, but this kit is primarily catered towards stopping the bleeding, hemorrhage control. And then going back to one of the first things that I mentioned in the kit, the cat tourniquet. So if the person's got trauma to an extremity, whether it's an arm or a leg, and you've got bright red blood squirting out, pulsating, you've got to put this on as fast as possible. That person could bleed out in 60 seconds and go into shock. It's good to have the kit, but you got to train and you got to know how to use, especially the cat tourniquet. Practice on yourself, practice on someone else. God forbid you get into a situation, you break an arm and your other one is bleeding out, you got to be able to put it on somehow. Teach others how to put it on as well. Now, as promised in the beginning of the video, I'm going to give you some tips. So first off, we're going to talk about the placement of the zippers. If you notice on mine, I have mine both in the middle. Why do we do that? Because if you have your zippers on one side and the zipper breaks, how are you supposed to open this? You're going to grab your trauma shears and you're going to cut it open. By keeping both zippers in the middle, if one zipper fails, you can always open up the other side. Another great tip, and this is very important, is communication. When you're going out on a trip with a crew, friends, whatever the case, communicate. Ask, who's got a first aid kit more than just a box of band-aids, please? Who's got the first aid kit? Who feels comfortable doing this? Who knows how to use certain things? What do you carry in your first aid kit? Where do you carry it? God forbid I or someone else goes down, we need to know where the first aid kits are and in which vehicle. Going back to the Sharpie, it's not just about marking the time on the cat tourniquet. It's also good to document things. God forbid, you know, things start happening. Patient started vomiting, patient lost consciousness. You got to record the time. If you don't have paper, write it on their arm, write it on their forehead, something. Mark the timing so that way when the proper medical attention is sought, they have a record of what happened to this person. My last tip to you is all about placement. Have this readily accessible. Like I mentioned, I place mine right behind my headrest. So God forbid something happens, I just hop out, pull the seat forward, yank it out. By having it on the back of the headrest, it's easily visible, especially when I've got the top, the doors, and the windows off the Jeep. So with all that said and done, I hope these tips have been helpful to you guys. Hope you learned something, and I hope that this has helped motivate you to carry a first aid kit in your vehicle. We need to educate the off-road community about proper first aid and planning, because disaster happens when we least expect it. So, to support the creation of more content like this, please rate the video, comment, subscribe, share. Thanks for watching. Until next time, Merch D, signing off.